Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Chanel Moore, and I'm the Peer Support Coordinator here at Lung Foundation Australia. We'd like to start by first acknowledging the traditional custodians of country throughout Australia and their continuing connection to land, sea, and community. We pay our respects to all elders, past, present, and emerging. Now, today's webinar is on carer wellbeing, caring for a loved one with lung cancer. And I'd like to thank the sponsors of this webinar, which include Bristol Myers Squibb, GlaxoSmithKline, Mayne Pharma, Roche, and the Lions Club of Lugano. Now, before we open up for our discussion today, I will just do a few housekeeping points. So the first one being that this webinar will be recorded, so it will be made available as an ongoing resource for our community, and we'll notify everyone who has registered for this lung cancer webinar series when that recording is available. We will also be holding a Q&A session towards the end of the webinar, so if you do have any questions, you are more than welcome to post them through that Q&A box, which you should see at the bottom of your screen. And if you do feel more comfortable posting anonymously, then you can do that as well. I will just say that answers to your questions will be of a general nature only. And we are going to be discussing mental health and wellbeing today. So during this webinar, if at any point you do feel upset or distressed and do need to leave and reach out for support, then please do so, whether it's with a friend, family, or an organisation such as Beyond Blue or Lifeline. Now, we are very, very fortunate to have two fantastic speakers joining us today. So we have Dr Maria Ftanou, a clinical psychologist from the Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre in Melbourne. Maria has had over 18 years of clinical experience in the field of psychosocial oncology and particularly working with people with lung cancer. And so today she's going to be sharing her insights into navigating life with lung cancer and managing the mental and emotional challenges as a carer. We are also fortunate to have with us Ken Bottrell, who is our carer representative for this webinar. And Ken is going to be joining us to share some of his experiences whilst caring for his wife, who sadly passed away from lung cancer, and how he and his daughter worked to manage their own well-being. Ken is also living with COPD, and we're very grateful for him to for opening up and sharing with us today and joining us. So thank you very much to both of you. What I'll do first is just hand over to Maria. So Maria, if you'd like to share your screen and chat with everyone joining us today.
Thanks, Chanel and the Lung Foundation of Australia for inviting me to be here today. I'm absolutely delighted to be here and talking about carer wellbeing in National Carer Week, and really acknowledging the care and the love and the support and that you provide to the people that you love. So as Chanel said, I am a clinical psychologist and I work here in Melbourne in this beautiful building. It's only 4 years old and we're still very proud of our building, but particularly I love working as a psychologist here because I get to work with clinicians, researchers, doctors, nurses, allied health staff who are really committed to bettering the lives of people with cancer and their families. So that's where I work. And what we're hoping to do today is spend a little bit of time talking about what is wellbeing, talking about how lung cancer challenges wellbeing, talking about some of the newfound roles and experiences that carers find themselves into. And I'm really looking forward to hearing you talk, Ken, because I think, you will talk about your experience a lot better and with a lot more clarity than I can. And then I'll share some tools that may help look after your mental health and wellbeing through this very difficult time. What well-being, there's lots of debate about what well-being is and what well-being isn't, and what's to be included in a definition of well-being. But generally, well-being is about looking after your physical well-being, your social well-being, your psychological well-being, and your spiritual well-being. It really refers to feeling confident that you have the resources to manage what life brings to you and manage the challenges that life may bring. One of the most common definitions that we see is the one I've got up here. So well-being is the presence of positive emotions and moods with the absence of the negative, more difficult emotions such as depression and anxiety, and feeling satisfied with life, and in simple terms, judging your life as positive and feeling good. So obviously, when a diagnosis of lung cancer hits, it really causes a major challenge to our well-being and the way we cope. As many of you already know, lung cancer is usually diagnosed at advance. The prognosis, although lots of new treatments are happening and the future is very hopeful, prognosis remains poor. Lung cancer for patients is associated with more distress than any other cancer. Between 11 to 40% of patients will experience depression and anxiety at some stage during their cancer diagnosis. And at advanced stage, these rates can go up to 70%. Their people with cancer experience a greater symptom burden than any other cancer. They have more fatigue, a loss of appetite, shortness of breath, cough and pain. And in addition to all that, 95% of people with lung cancer experience stigma. They feel shame, guilt for having the illness. And this significantly impacts on their well-being, their quality of life, on their ability to ask for help or believe that they're going to actually get the help and the treatment that they want. And as we know, cancer is never experienced on its own. It's not something that one person goes through. All these things impact on families, on children, on loved ones. It really is a shared experience. So what is a carer? I'm not quite sure if people resonate with this term or whether it addresses what people feel their role is. But it's a term that we often use, and I'm not quite sure we have a better one at the moment. But it's really defined as doing what needs to be done for the person that you love and care for. And carers for people with cancer tend to be spouses, partners, children, close relatives, friends or neighbours. So you've gone from having your relationship with the person that you love to now being a carer, and your life takes on a whole bunch of new responsibilities. All of a sudden, sometimes almost, you know, really quite quickly, you have these new sets of responsibilities that you have to kind of fit into the life you already had. So carers often talk about needing to be advocates, needing to fight for treatments for patients, needing to advocate that they get the best treatment or advocate for additional treatments such as the allied health professions. They feel that they go home and they need to monitor their loved one's symptoms or monitor the side effects of medications. They become record keepers of what happened and when did they go to the GP and when was that first scan, and then they become holders of this new knowledge and information, so if their loved one forgets some information, that they can provide that information to them. You learn to navigate a complex medical system of doctors, nurse coordinators, physios, exercise physiologists, community resources. Then your role changes at home as well. Carers also take on a lot of practical duties. Home duties, cooking, cleaning, additional looking after other family members, looking after pets. You become taxi drivers and transporting not only your loved one, but maybe some of the other family members. You help with personal care and assistance. You have to sort out legal stuff, wills and finances and Centrelink, and fill out form after form after form. Carers also then have to have some emotional responsibilities. You want to show your loved one that you're there and that you care, and you want to be there throughout this whole experience. You want to give them company. You want to build their resilience. You want to encourage them and reassure them and cheerleader them on when they have to go through some difficult challenges or a new treatment. Then there's these social aspects that you find yourself in, where you have to keep family and friends informed about what's going on. You want to make sure that your loved one has contact with others, so you may help them establish those contacts. And sometimes in really difficult times, you might have to try and think about what you can do as a family, a new activity, and that's something that you can enjoy together. And carers take on these roles with little training, very little information, and very little acknowledgement of the roles that they do. And that includes from sometimes our hospital. So sometimes carers will come into appointment, will be told a whole bunch of stuff of what's going on, and sometimes we don't even ask, and how are you going with this? So that's a lot. This new role that people find themselves in is a lot. And then, so this impacts on carers' emotional experience of caring. So anxiety, up to 61% of carers experience anxiety. You're worried that you might have missed something. Sadness is very common. Sometimes carers feel very guilty, like guilty that perhaps that they don't have the cancer, or guilty that they don't know what to do, or guilty that they've taken like some time out or haven't been able to attend an appointment. Sometimes carers feel very hopeless and helpless because they just don't know how to help or ease the pain, or how to make their loved one feel better. Carers experience, they talk to me a lot about their grief that they experience, the grief of a relationship that perhaps was in a certain way, and now there's this new relationship, and there is grief about all the changes, grief of watching your partner's body and functioning, or loved one's body and functioning change. There's anger associated with that, anger for, you know, maybe future plans and what you had hoped for, and anger that this is happening to your loved one. Confusion about the medical system, the diagnosis, about all the complex things that are happening. And about 40% of carers also feel depressed during this process, and they and increased drinking and maybe some drug taking to cope with the current situation. Most carers do love doing what they do and want to give their loved ones the best experience and want to support them through every stage that they're going through. So they do this willingly and lovingly and with the greatest kindness, but it does impact on them emotionally as well. Other things that carers go through, their roles are definitely changed. There's about 50% of loved ones and discuss that the cancer causes financial strain in their relationship. It leads to about 70% of carers reduce their employment hours, and about 8% of carers also just stop working altogether. So, and this impacts, causes a lot of isolation for carers, and it sometimes feels like you're doing this alone. And there's sometimes, because of all the increased caring duties, carers often let go of some of the things that they used to do or form their identity to look after their loved ones. So sometimes there is also a loss of that sense of self in the process. There are lots of things that we can do to look after ourselves, and self-care is one of those key things that we can do to look after ourselves. Self-care is the intentional time taken on a daily basis to look after yourself. Self-care helps with building resilience. It helps fueling you. It helps prevent some mental health concerns And it also helps not only prevent mental health symptoms, but also help manage them if you are experiencing anxiety or lots of worry. However, many carers don't feel that they're able to invest in self-care for themselves. If they feel guilty and they feel that they need to just be there and do what needs to be done, and there's no time for self-care. So it's really, really, really important that you do focus on your self-care. And how do you do this? First step is to acknowledge your efforts. If you don't like the term carer, find a way to acknowledge that your life has changed and you've taken on all these additional responsibilities, and acknowledging the emotions that come with it, the commitment and the love, but also how hard some of these additional tasks are. Reach out and connect with others. See the people that you love, that encourage you, that give you lots of energy, that boost you. Try and meet some new people through peer support groups. Try not to ignore special events, birthdays or weddings or things that you would have done once. Keep those special events going for you and your loved one. Look after your physical health. We've had many, many carers just really neglect their physical health and feel it by the end of it all, just feel exhausted. So keep your GP appointments. Exercise daily. Exercise will give you energy. So I think that what we recommend for people with cancer is to exercise about 30 minutes a day. And that is to go outside, go for a walk, but to walk at a pace that leaves you breathless. So to do that on a daily basis. Think about what you're consuming. When we're really stressed, when we eat, we just kind of grab whatever's in front of us and it doesn't really fuel us. So think about what you're eating and your own nutritional meals. Sometimes we focus on, carers talk about making sure that their loved one eats and making, cooking a whole bunch of different things so that their loved one gets the nourishment and the things that they need. But think about what you're eating and what you're consuming. Looking after your sleep patterns. So worry and all the tasks and the list of things you need to do may keep you up at night. So having a look at your sleep routine, making sure you get up as soon as you get up in the morning to go outside to get sunlight. Getting sunlight sets your body clock in the morning, and darkening the room in the evening will again tell your body it's time to go to sleep. So making sure that you keep a little bit of routine with that. Creating a good sleep environment for yourself. If you investing in a meditation or relaxation CD to help you fall asleep, to calm the mind and help you fall asleep. Writing your worries down so you're not taking them at night and thinking about them before you go to sleep. If you are tossing and turning at night in bed, get up and if you're not tossing and turning for more than 20 minutes, do something quietly in another room and only go back to bed when you're tired. Don't keep trying to go to bed or fall asleep in that moment and keep watching the time, because that would just rev you up and keep you up. Become a little more aware of your own resources. Be reflective and realistic in your approach, which I think is about prioritising on what you can and can't do. You can't do everything. And you really need to take good care of yourself and learn to say no to some things so you can better care for the ones that you love as well. Find what is meaningful to you. It could be seeing your friends. It could be going for a walk in nature. It could be listening to your favourite CD. It could be building something. Find what is meaningful and try not to let go of that and do that frequently. Making sure there's a way that you can take time out. And you can do that by inviting a friend over to spend it if you can't leave your loved one alone. But scheduling a regular time out, a date with yourself, time to go and do whatever it is you want to do, play golf, have a beer with a mate, go to a movie if outside COVID time, if we're allowed to ever go again, but finding something that you are able to do and do it regularly and giving yourself some time out. My next slide has some ideas of, if people are out of ideas of what they can do, you can write in a journal. Is that another, some other self-care ideas, gratitudes list, spend time with your pets, listen to music, yoga, making time to read, playing a board game, having a movie marathon, treating yourself to something that you love, some flowers, a gift, like make really investing in self-care for yourself. Because carers have become medical professionals, monitoring symptoms and checking in with patients, and it's important that one thing that increases anxiety significantly is when you watch someone you love suffer and not know who to contact or what to do or who their treating team is, or not knowing what to look out for. So it's important that you talk with your loved one, make sure that they give you permission to talk to their treating team and the treating team can talk to you, and then contact the treating team when you're unsure. Ask about what symptoms are really that you need to monitor, what you should really be worried about, what not to be so worried about, making sure you know who to contact, what's the best way. If you can't get onto that nurse coordinator or the doctor, who do you contact next? Where do you go to next? Having these conversations is really important. Talking about your feelings to your loved one is really important. What usually happens in a lot of relationships is, especially carers, you don't want to talk about how you're feeling. You don't want to talk about how hard things might be because you don't want to put that on to your loved one that's already suffering. But what happens then is that you lose some of that intimate conversation. So it is important to find ways to communicate about your feelings. And usually some of the things that you're worried about, your partner is worried about. And if you're not talking about some of the things, you might become resentful or angry or at the situation. So it is important to find a way to talk about it. If you really can't talk to your loved one about it, find a good friend that you can talk to about it. If you are talking about difficult things with your loved one, stay on topic, listen to their point of view, and listen in a way that is curious, but you listen with empathy and listen with to trying to really understand their side as well. I know you people and in your caring role, there's been a lot of compromise, but with difficult topics, you might both need to negotiate a little bit. Ask for help outside the family unit. You will get offers. People will say, what can I do to help? Many people have not experienced a cancer diagnosis. They don't know how to help, and they don't know that this is a marathon. It's not just the first month when we get diagnosed. So it's important to have a think about what are some of the tasks that you can ask people to do. You know, can the neighbour take out the bins, for you? Can they do the lawns while they're doing their lawn? Can they do your lawn? Can someone do some laundry? Can someone else pick up the kids or have them, for a few hours in the evening? But come up with your list and ask people for help. So it's important to ask for help. People want to help, they just don't know. A lot of them just don't know what to do. And also they just don't know how long this is. And remind yourself what's important in your relationship and share that stuff with the person that you love. We often focus on the day-to-day living of how to manage the symptom and how to manage whatever's at hand, but really focusing on what's important to the unit, what's important to your parent or your partner, or focusing what's really important and what really matters. And the next one's really hard, but trying to have some cancer-free time with the person that you're caring for, so that you both don't, you know, obviously if there's symptoms and things that need to be attended, you attend to them. But if, you know, give yourself some break, not to read about cancer, not to watch cancer, not to discuss cancer, to try and do something else that you used to love, or talk about some of the other stuff that you've enjoyed together in the past, or even reflect and see photos or memories of travel or other things that you've done, but making sure that you carve some time where it's cancer-free time. One of the things that often we talk about is what looking after a person with cancer, we can have some thoughts that are not that helpful as well. And we often in therapy use cognitive behavior therapy, which looks at the relationship between your thoughts, your feelings and behaviors. And sometimes we might need to adjust a little, our thoughts a little, to adjust the way we feel. And usually when we're very stressed, we do things like catastrophize, overgeneralize, view ourselves in a negative light, that we are not resilient, or we can't cope, or we don't have the resources to cope with our situation. So I'll just give you an example of what I mean on the next slide. So if you're feeling overwhelmed, you're probably telling yourself stuff like, I can't cope with this, I can't do this anymore, no, you know, which are kind of just looking at one side or of what's going on for you. You might withdraw, you might forget about your self-care, you might do a whole bunch of problem solving or going through a list of additional tasks that you have to do, which may make you feel more overwhelmed, and you might continue in this spiral of working. So what we recommend is that you stop and ask yourself some questions. Are you jumping to conclusions? Is it true that you can't cope? Or is today a bad day? What's the evidence that you can't cope and that you haven't been coping? Is there anything you can do to help you with your coping? What are the advantages or disadvantages of thinking in this way? And the question I love most is, if your kind friend came up to you and could see you saying, I'm not coping, I'm just overwhelmed, this is a disaster, what am I going to do? What would that kind friend say to you? And to kind of ask some of these questions. The other thing that we recommend for reducing stress is mindfulness. Mindfulness over the last sort of 30 years has become quite popular in the field of psychology. And it means kind of paying attention to the current moment, not thinking too far ahead. So if we think about all the what ifs and what can happen down the track, we feel overwhelmed. So mindfulness just brings us back to this moment and focusing on just this moment. And there's a whole bunch of techniques. And if you want to learn some mindfulness, Open Ground has mindfulness courses across Australia. There's a Smiling Mind app as well that you can look on your phone. There's the Headspace app as well, which is an American one. And you can try some of these techniques, but it really teaches you to just focus on now and bring your thoughts to the present. And you can focus on that by learning to focus on your breath, learning some stretches. And mindfulness can help you understand how your body responds to stress as well, and help you change some of those difficult thinking patterns. And it's okay also, if you're struggling, if you're feeling depressed, it's more than okay to seek psychological support as well. Speak to your GP, speak to a counsellor, speak to a psychologist. It's better to speak. There's no right or wrong time. It's never too early to seek help. It's never too late. Talking to someone about how you feel helps you change your perspective. It helps you cope with the situation. It helps you plan and prioritize and come and see things in a different way. Don't do this alone. There is many supports out there. And just to finish up, here are some other resources that you might be interested in. that has lots and lots of information. So thank you for listening, and I'll hand over to Chanel.
Thank you so much for sharing your insights and a lot of those practical things that people can do as well. And I hope that was able to give people some direction as to ways that they can either look after their practice self-care. But it was also really interesting to hear you talk about all the different roles that that a carer does, and all of that medical knowledge that they acquire, and just all that work that they do. So I hope that also provided some comfort and some guidance to everyone watching as well. And now I'm really pleased that we can hand over to Ken. And Ken, you can take yourself off mute if you like. And if you'd like to share with us all your experiences and a bit of your story. So I'll now hand over to you.
Okay, thanks, Chanel. And Maria, that was fabulous, mate. Really good stuff. Practical, useful, lovely stuff. I wish the hell I'd seen all that 7 years ago, but I didn't, however. My presentation is no slides, no nothing. I'm very much a novice at this, and I'm actually doing a course next week to try and learn how to do Zoom properly. So bear with me. I'll do my best. I'll just be talking about my experience, strength and hope, really, about my journey for the last 7 years. I'm Ken Bottrell, and I'm talking today about my role as a carer for my darling wife of 51 years, Dale, and her five years and 4 months journey with lung cancer. Dale, when she was diagnosed, was fit and well, 66 years old. We just returned from our big dream trip up north as far as Cooktown, and over a period of around about 3 months, and we had an absolute ball. We rode our bikes, we ate far too much, we swam, slept, visited all sorts of amazing things, and did great things. We really had a great time. And Dale showed no signs at all of anything being wrong with her. In fact, she thrashed me on the bikes all the time because we have COPD, and I'd be huffing and puffing and carrying on. And she'd be sitting at the top of the hill waiting for me. Come on, hurry up, hurry up. So we really had a great time, and I look back as that is a really wonderful experience. And the only indication that anything was even slightly wrong was that Dale had a small lump under her left armpit. She didn't look at it because when you're living in caravan parks, you don't go around examining your armpits in the mirror in the middle of the thing. People would think you're a bit weird. They probably do anyway, but I don't care. So she didn't do anything about it. It wasn't causing her any grief. But when she came back, she went and saw her GP, her long-term GP, who delivered our daughter, which is a long time ago. And he was a bit concerned, so he asked for tests and then scans and ultimately a biopsy. And the prognosis was that Dale had stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer. And to say we were shattered is a vast understatement. It really did totally shatter us. Came out of the blue, leaving his surgery to get home. Dale drove. I just simply couldn't stop crying. I just couldn't. And then I started swearing, and it went from there. But from that point on, we embarked on what seemed like an endless round of treatments and tests and hospitalisation, doctor's appointments, scans and so on. But we discussed it, and we decided that we would try as much as we could continue our lifestyle, and that was to go socialising, caravanning, hang out, have the grandkids hang out with us. We've got a pool, and there's nothing more fun than having jumping in and out the pool with the grandkids and our daughter, of course, and her husband and friends and so on. So we tried wherever possible to keep up the lifestyle, albeit at a much slower pace, that what we had before. We weren't just going to sit back and accept that, you know, okay, Dale was seriously ill and we couldn't do anything. And not us, we decided we would not do that. We would get on with our lives as best we could and however we could. And we were greatly helped in that by Dale's oncologist, Associate Professor Paul Mitchell, who's been somewhat of a mentor to me and kept stopping me in for things. And that's how we get involved. And he's a lovely bloke and he was so helpful to Dale. And he helped arrange for many, many appointments as much as possible. So we could have, you know, a few weeks away or a couple of weeks away. Towards the end, we did things like going down to stay a couple of days at the RACV, different places, because you could relax and enjoy it. And Paul helped greatly in facilitating that. And the rest of the medical team were just as good. They were so supportive in every possible way. And you know, I would ask all sorts of questions. I had started a lung cancer support group. I'd become a patient, what am I called, a support care worker at the Austin. And I got involved, and that was one of my ways of coping, was to get involved in doing stuff. I couldn't fix it, but I'm not the sort of person to sit back and accept it. So I got involved and I did courses at Cancer Council Vic. I met up with and dealt with a lot of people at the Lung Foundation and so on. And I found that by learning things, I could not only help Dale, but I could perhaps help someone else and get out of my own head, because that was a big problem at times. And you know, wish I'd met Maria along those days. It would have been so good. But anyway, I decided that when Dale was diagnosed, I'd do whatever I could to help her with her future. And whatever she needed, Dale was an incredibly independent, strong woman. And I told her straight up that I wasn't going to interfere. I wasn't going to try and take over. I wasn't going to try and run her life in any way. I wouldn't do anything unless she asked me. If she asked me, I was happy to do anything at all, but she had to ask. I wasn't going to interfere and start pushing my way in, and that's what we did. And she did remain pretty independent, you know, right up and towards the end. And that was really good. I'm really pleased that I was able to do that and stick to it and so on. And yeah, so today I've actually done something a little different. I've talked about this before, but and I've talked to Chanel about it, and I actually asked our daughter Lisa if she would write something down. Lisa is very much like her mother was, very strong woman, independent, very, very private. But I wanted Lisa to share her thoughts and feelings and such during this time, because that's a totally different point of view from my point of view as a husband, as a daughter. And I asked her to come on today, but she said, "No, Dad, no, that's your job. You do that." So, okay, so here I am. So I'm going to read what Lisa wrote. This is what my gorgeous daughter wrote. From a daughter's point of view, I helped care for my beautiful mum, who lived 5.5 years knowing she had terminal lung cancer. At the beginning of the journey, I was 39 years old, married, mother of 2 children, a 5-year-old and a 1-year-old, and worked part-time, kept fit and active and enjoyed a social life, maintained a house, enjoyed a camping-style holidays, and being close to family. A little heading, maintaining the well-being whilst being a carer. First heading Lisa's got is exercise. I've always been active, but felt that I wanted to do something more during this period, something that I felt represented Mum's strength, something that would challenge me. So during Mum's journey, I ran 5 my half marathons, each 20 kilometres. The running resembled mum's strength and get up and go attitude. I always said, if mum can manage radiation, chemo, brain surgery, and a massive disruption to her world, not giving up for 1 minute, then I can run a marathon a year. I also found that doing approximately 4 training runs a week gave me time out from everything which was going on. And I did group exercise with classes and went for walks. The physical and mental benefit of exercise and being with friends works for me. It was also of assistance training with a friend who had previously been through a similar experience with her mother. The first half marathon I completed, I also raised some funds for the Olivia Newton John Cancer Wellness and Research Centre, and it was comforting to see the support I received. She got a huge support. I did the fundraising once, not feeling overly comfortable about asking for donations again and again. Her next subheading is utilise key support people. Excluding immediate family, I found it best not to spread myself too thin, and I did not want to talk about what was going on to everyone all the time. I did not want to put pressure on anyone to always feel like they must ask how's mum. I would limit the response, and I try not to weigh down anyone all the time. Just speak about it when something significant happened. It was really draining for me, and I guess by doing this, I was looking after myself and just spoke about things when I needed to. I was really lucky to have a friend whose mum had passed away from cancer 1 year before mum passed, as mentioned previously. Everyone's journey is different, but she understood more than people who have not been through it. I was also blessed by having another good friend who was a nurse at Peter Mac, and she also had lost a parent. Her knowledge and support was amazing. Well, not only to Lisa, but also to me. She's just a gorgeous woman. Helped me so much. Having multiple people support me in my life assisted in not putting all the weight on my husband's shoulders. The next subheading is finding time to switch off. Every day, mum was on my mind, but I tried to make a point of focusing on my family and what was going on and our world too. Spending happy times with the kids, going to their school commitments, sports, social engagements, and even just walking around the block or playing in the backyard gave me a moment out. Next heading, keeping some normality. Yes. I found myself trying to keep my life moving. The only thing I really was mindful of was spending as much time with mum without dropping everything in the process. I still kept my job, my health, my friendships, and normality in my life, but just dedicated every spare minute to helping and making memories with mum without it taking over completely. I was blessed to have mum and dad living a short walk from us, making things easier to manage. She's lovely. Another heading, have you and your loved ones supported each other? Subheading, attended medical appointments and at times recorded conversations so that we as a family could then dissect the information to really understand what was going on. Really important, especially early days. You get overwhelmed with so much information, and Lisa would bring in the thing and she'd record it and then she'd transcribe it because she just don't remember. It's just too hard, it's too much. Remembering important dates is also noted, including but not limited to treatments and understanding what's vague with my understanding. Understanding what's going on and how mum would possibly be feeling in the lead up and post appointments. Very important. Not being vague with my understanding. Actually understanding. Ask questions. Ask questions. Keep asking questions so you know what's happening. then supporting her around the home with shopping, cleaning, or simple things like cutting fresh flowers from the garden and having a cuppa. And very regular visits with the grandkids to hang out, because they always put a smile on her face. It didn't matter how crooked she was. And a memory book. Lisa came up with the idea. I put out a request to Mum's closest friends and a few of her friends to email me a favourite memory of Mum. I was overwhelmed by the responses and created a book to present to her so she could hear everyone's special thoughts and feelings. This way she got to read them before passing. It was a happy book that lay by her bed. It was just wonderful. Talk about everything. Don't have any regrets about stuff you should have said, could have said. Right down to the final bits, the funeral arrangements and everything else. We talked it right through, everything. Lisa and Dale and I went over everything we wanted to, we needed to, we felt to, and we just were up front about everything. There was no hiding or mysteries or anything. We just up front. Very important, we felt. And listen, just listen. Sometimes it's really hard. And Lisa said she didn't just ask questions. She listened and tried to understand so she could be supported in the right way. And the other, getting towards the end, acceptance. Mum and I understood her fate and we collectively got on with what needed to be done and got the help where she needed it. It wasn't about being with her all the time and dwelling on support. Dwelling on the situation the whole time. And some practical ideas for getting support and navigating services, the council. Lisa got to be support, some booklets and stuff. They were incredibly helpful to us with the support group with information. The Lung Foundation were equally as supportive and helpful with information and products and things so we could run meetings and do lung cancer days, shine a light on lung cancer. We had some couple of fabulous days where lots of people turned up. Living Newton John Wellness Centre were of a great help when at times we couldn't cope and we just needed to go somewhere. And the Eastern Palliative Care Association, which we only became aware of towards the end of Dale's journey, and it's something that I've become a bit of an advocate for because it's not talked about enough. Palliative care doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to die next week or whatever. It just means get help. If I have a regret, I didn't get in touch with them soon enough. Could have been in touch with them way sooner than we did. Everybody, it's just been such a help. And being involved with people like this lovely lady today with Chanel and talking about this stuff is such, it's a part of the healing process for me. I don't know, I get upset still, and I always will, because a part of my soul is gone, and that will always be the case. But that's not going to stop me. Have the fire in my belly to do what I can to carry the message and try and help others. And like, if I've helped anyone, even a little bit today, I've done what I set out to. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Oh, Ken, thank you so much for such a moving story and for being so just so honest and just being your lovely, genuine self and letting us know about the lovely time that you had with Dale and the camping and just how special as well that you invited Lisa to share her thoughts and what she did. And again, I'm no doubt that what she shared will be of comfort and help to other people to have some practical steps moving forward on things that they can do. And thank you so much to both of you for sharing all that you did. And I know that this will be really valuable for people, not just watching now, but watching the recording as and when they need to. So thank you so much. What we'll do is we'll go into a Q&A. So if anyone does have any questions, you can put them through that Q&A box, and I'll direct them to either or of you. So I'll just have a look and see. We'll give everyone a few minutes to submit their questions. It looks like we've got one here. Okay, so this one is actually around, sleeping and sort of coping at nighttime. And Maria, you spoke a little bit about sort of worries and writing things down. And this person has said they find it harder to cope at night, to the point where they're thinking about the what ifs and cannot sleep. So I wonder if there's any other suggestions that you might have, or Ken as well, around trying to sleep.
Yeah. I'm curious to hear what Ken has to say about this, but if you want some psychological kind of strategies of what we recommend is this one sounds a little weird, but having a worry time during the day. So each day you might select, 10 a.m. where you sit for half an hour or 20 minutes and you write your worries each day. As worries come up throughout the day, you say, I'm not going to worry about you now. I'm going to worry about you during the day at 10 a.m. every day. So you've got a place for your worry, and it's not anywhere near your bedtime. The other thing that I would recommend is doing an evening routine of relaxation, quietening the house. If your worries do keep creeping up at night, maybe you can just jot them down on a little notepad then, and again, try and take them out of your head. But reminding yourself that at night, during your sleep, you're not going to solve the worries. You're not going to solve the what ifs, because the what ifs may or may never happen. So just keep reminding yourself that this is your rest time. This is your rest time, and trying to get a better night's sleep. Ken?
Yeah, Maria, yeah, fabulous, spot on, mate. I do probably three things. I meditate. I have found that meditation, I'm not very good at it. I do it my own inimitable way. I do it every morning without fail. That's the first thing I do. And I have a diary or journal, or call it what you will, where I write up stuff that I don't have answers to, that I need to talk to someone about, a professional or a friend or whoever. And I also, if I can't go to sleep at night and I haven't handed it over, I actually break the pattern. I get up. I love reading. I'm a reader. I'm an avid reader. So I get up. I try not to look at stupid electronic devices, as hard as it might be, and I'll do some reading and have a Milo and a biscuit or whatever, but just to break the pattern, because if I don't break the pattern, it'll just keep going. And I had a night just two nights ago, actually, and I haven't had it for ages. I was pretty much awake all night. My just very quickly, without a sob story, one of my best mates of 60 plus years is in hospital with leukemia. He's very unlikely to come out. When you've been friends with someone that long, it's a tough gig, and I can't go in and shake hands and give him a cuddle. And my mother-in-law, Dale's mum, is 99 3/4 or something, is not well, has just been transferred to hospital. She's trying to hang out till she's 100 in January. Lisa has got a lot on her plate. She's running that. So all that has been running around in my head. And I had a night where I just couldn't settle. And so I gave myself permission to not worry about it. I said, well, bugger it, it's only sleep. I'll be right. And I can't even remember what I did, but I did something that was... I wanted to do, And the night passed, and I had Milo at 3 a.m. and I finished up with bacon and eggs at 6 a.m. and I had a snooze at 3 p.m. So, but I got through the night and I didn't allow it to really take over. And what I'm saying, Maria, is I have techniques where I actually implement them, and they don't always work automatically. And even good old meditation, which I love, it does sometimes, it just won't budge. So what am I going to do now? So I do something else.
Sometimes it's just a bad night.
Yeah, it's just a bad night. That's what it is, and I accept that. And I carry on a lot, and I talk people. I drive people mad talking about being proactive. I try and be proactive, not just lay there and wallow in my misery because I can't sleep. And so it's a multi-pronged thing for me.
Well, thank you for both of you sharing some things that people can try and help them. And I think, you know, that's really what you said, Maria, about sometimes it is just a bad night. And yeah, I hope that those nights are few and far between and that people are able to try some of these techniques that you've suggested. Now, we've got time for just one more question before we wrap up. And so this person has said that, you know, life just feels like a bit of a roller coaster, and they're just wondering, is that normal? Is that how it is for a lot of people? And so, Ken, I wonder if I'll throw that question to you and if you'd like to share your thoughts around that.
Yeah, it is. And I think I said that. It does. It becomes a roller coaster and a succession of importance. This, that, my wife's little white Subaru, I could just walk out and say to her, hospital, and we'd be off to the Austin. Like it was just such a thing. And your whole life is gets turned upside down and inside out. And it is a roller coaster. Yes, it is. And this is one of the reasons. The other thing I forgot to mention to Maria that I actually do, I have a massage once a fortnight. I have a standing appointment once a fortnight. I was doing yoga and I couldn't afford both. And I thought, an hour's massage is just so nice. Just to let go and lay there and have a massage is just so nice. And that's my treat. That's what I really see as a treat. That has helped me lots of times. I go in there and I look forward to it. It's especially in Melbourne at present, and anyone that's going through all the usual stuff, and we're also stuck with the 5K thing. It was horrendous on the roller coaster without having that restriction. But having that restriction would make it even worse because your friends and fellows and the people that would pop in and see you, and you could pop in and see, you can't do it. So I really feel for you guys that are in that position of present. Yeah, roller coaster, mate, with the handbrakes falling off. It's about what it feels like. Yeah.
Oh, well, thank you again for showing other people that what they're going through, they're not alone, and that you've also had that feeling as well. So look, I feel like we could keep talking for a while, but we have come to the end of the webinar. So thank you again to both of you so much for coming on and chatting with everyone. Thank you to everyone for, coming in your corner of the world, logging on to your computer and listening and submitting your questions. And I will just take this opportunity to remind people that Lung Foundation Australia does have a lung cancer support nurse telephone service that's available nationwide, and that's for patients, family and carers, and our nurse can talk with you, provide evidence-based information around your diagnosis and your treatment and your well-being. So just if anyone does have any questions around speaking with that nurse, accessing different resources, or even connecting in with other people who are going through a similar experience, please do call our information and support centre on the number that you should hopefully see on your screen. You're welcome to give us a call and we can see how we can support you. So thank you again. And that's it for now. So please take care and see you at the next webinar.